Welcome to Chess Understanding. My name is John Montgomery, and today we have a brilliant attacking game by the newest member of Team USA, Levon Aronian. This thing is amazing. It begins very calmly, just a ready opening, which is very indirect. You know, knight f3, knight f6, c4. White's saying, you know, nothing to see here. It doesn't really foretell what is going to happen later in the game when white attacks black with a withering kingside attack. It all starts very stealthily. Nothing to see here, folks, is what he's saying. E6, G3, D5, bishop to G2. White's putting the bishop on the long diagonal. He just wants to nibble at that B7 pawn. Just long-term, very small initiative. Just put that bishop on the long diagonal, nibble on that queenside, a little bit of pressure. Nothing to worry about. Black prepares in a very orthodox way. Castles. D4, transposing into a Catalan opening. And this opening has recently been described as an opening where you get a slight advantage with nothing to worry about. It's a safe, long-term advantage. Little do people know that this game is not going to be safe at all. White's going to really go for it a little bit later. Black takes the pawn at c4. He says, yeah, white's going to be able to capture this pawn back, but while white's doing that, I'm going to get to make a couple of moves to help neutralize white's pressure. Queen c2 to recover the pawn on c4. Black plays a6, wants to expand on the queen side with b5. White says, not so fast, my friend. That b5 move you want to play, I'm going to put the kibosh on that by playing a4. Now black plays bishop to d7. What black wants to do is to play that bishop to c6 and neutralize that bishop at g2 on the long diagonal. He says, well, that bishop at g2 is white's best minor piece. It's white's pride and joy. So I want to neutralize that piece so, you know, I can take away any advantage white might have. White recaptures the pawn, equalizing material. Black again carries on with that plan, bishop to c6. The bishop goes to f4. Get it off the back rank so you can develop your pieces. a5. What black is doing is he's getting that b4 square. He's saying, I own that square. And I'm going to take that knight at b8. I'm going to go to a6, b4, and I'll have my knight on a strong square on the queen side. I'm going to own that b4 square. White plays again orthodox chess, knight to c3. Black's plan continues. Knight a6, going to hop into b4. Knight e5. Whoa, this is shocking. He's allowing black to take the light squared bishop at g2, the pride and joy of his minor pieces. But white knows a little something here. He's saying, yeah, you can take away my pride and joy, but I still have a couple of aces up my sleeve. Black takes the bishop as expected. King takes g2. Knight to d5, a good square in the center of the board. It hits the bishop at f4 and just kind of coordinates those pieces. Rook a to d1. Now, black plays c6, which gives some strength to his center and queen side, but he probably should have gone ahead and taken that bishop at f4. That would have compromised white's pawn structure a little bit, and white's still okay, but the game would have gone down a very different path. I think black should probably have chopped that off when he had the chance. And white says, okay, you had your shot. I'm coming back to c1. I want to keep this bishop. Since you didn't take it, I don't want you to have another chance to take it. Now, knight a to b4. Now, the knight's on a good square. It looks good. It's a weak square. It can't be kicked out by another pawn. That's all great. But white gets to do some things here that black may not be expecting. At this point, the game is in completely new territory. At this point, no other games have been played in this position. There were some played after, but up to this point, none. So they're in completely new territory. And everybody that says all these grandmasters, they just memorize a bunch of moves. Well, here we see Aronian. This isn't memorization here. This is chess understanding, folks. Watch how he uses his understanding of this structure to launch the h-pawn up the board, stick the e5 pawn, the e-pawn to e5 like a bone in the throat of black's position, and attack, attack, attack. It is brilliant. e4, kicking the knight and gaining space in the center. Knight to b6, gains a tempo against the queen, but does the knight really want to be over there? Queen e2, Knight to d7, instructive moment. White has more space because of those central pawns. Black has less space. And when you have less space, you want to trade off pieces so you can have an easier time maneuvering in the less space that you have. White, however, who has more space, wants to avoid trading pieces and take advantage of that space. So he says, no, not so fast, my friend. I'm bringing you back to f3. Black plays rook to e8. It clears the f8 square. You can put the bishop there or the knight there to maybe to help defend on the king's side. Now, boom, h4, chess understanding. He knows that in this particular structure, which we call the Slav structure, you often attack with the h pawn and the e pawn. Queen to b6, not a bad move. It moves away from the king's side and supports the move c5, which you might be able to play later. Knight g5. Aronian says, okay, I'm coming. Now I'm going to start moving my pieces towards my opponent's king to try to deliver checkmate. Black says, get out of here. I'm kicking your knight. Now, because I'm threatening to take your knight with my pawn, you have to move it back. But what does Aronian do? He doesn't move it at all. Rook to h1. He's saying, yeah, you can take that knight, but if you do, I'm going to get a vicious attack down the h-file. He didn't take the knight, but if he did take the knight, this is a line that could have happened. Hg5, hg5, g6, queen to f3. And then if black moves the queen back to d8 to help in the defense, watch this. Rook h8 check, a rook sacrifice. King takes queen to f7, and there is literally nothing black can do to prevent white's rook from coming to h1 and finishing off the game. Black is helpless. The game would be over if he takes the knight. So instead of taking the knight, he moves the bishop back to f8. So now, Aronian plays e5, the other key move when you're attacking in this structure. The e5 pawn, the h4 pawn, keys to the attacking play. Now, in this position, if you, you know, look at this, put it into a computer or whatever, black's still fine. Black's still okay, but actually defending over the board in a real game, in a position like this, very hard. Black should play the thematic move c5 here. That's a very common move in this structure, and he should play it here. Instead, he plays f5, which is the only real mistake in the game, but it's a decisive one. Believe it or not, after f5, the game is, functionally speaking, over, and the attack is already irresistible. White plays queen to h5 with a threat of going to g6, h7, checkmate. Black plays rook to e7 to try to defend at least a little bit along the rank. Queen to g6. He's threatening mate, so you have to take the knight. Pawn takes, pawn takes. Now, white's down a piece, but the attack is irresistible. Only now does black play c5, but it's too little too late, and it opens up a pathway for white's knight to go to d6. Now that b5 is not controlled by that pawn anymore, he can go knight b5, knight d6, and control the f7 square. It's just, it's curtains. So knight to b5, beginning that process. Queen to c6, check. It's one last check, but it's just, again, too little too late. He blocks the check with the pawn with f3. Cd4, queen h7, check. King f7, knight to d6, check. And there's literally nowhere the king can go. The only thing keeping him from being checkmated is that the queen can take on d6, but then you just lose your whole queen. So the game is over. It would look something like this, queen d6, e d6. Now what do you do? You know, his opponent Zhao is a strong grandmaster, 2600 GM. In a game like this, you don't say to yourself, well, maybe he'll stalemate me in a king and queen versus king ending or something like that. No, it's over. The player like Aronian, who is currently top five in the world, you resign. So this is a brilliant example of Aronian's play, and we welcome him to Team USA. We are glad you are with us.